Hello everyone, my name is Paul Morrow. I'm the lead practitioner of the creative arts at Westminster Special School, and I work alongside Tanya, who's the assistant head there. I coordinate the West London in Creative Arts Festival, and I'm co-author of the Cultural Inclusion Manifesto, and I recently wrote a book, Cultural Inclusion for Young People with SEND, for NASEN, as part of their Spotlight series. So I'm here today to, is it clicking there?
No, give you a support.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, here we go. I'm here to talk to you about anti-abelist pedagogy. It's been described by Dr. Claire Penketh at Liverpool Hope University as an essential pedagogy. I'm going to do that by talking to you about a case study that I used in the book initially, that was with an outside organisation called Open City. And through that, we described some of the characteristics of anti-abelist pedagogy. And then a much more kind of focused project to extend our understanding of anti-abelist pedagogy with both Marc and Luke, who are here, to go through some of the structure and methodology of the project, the findings of the project, and what we think the implications of the project are.
So interrupt
for
that second. Is it all right if you record the presentation?
So Open City, it was a project looking at the built environment. The aim of the project was for our students to engage with an architect, an architecture to be facilitated by Marc and Luke. Luke, musician, Marc, visual artist, with a group of autistic young people aged between 8 and 11 years of age. So those are the participants in the project. I was involved in supporting the project in terms of bringing people together, kind of brokering the project in that way with the outside organisation. And as a school, we only enter into partnerships with cultural organisations through co-production. So making sure that we were supporting the co-production of the project to make sure that the impact was beneficial for our young people, for our teachers, and for the outside organisation. And it was very much what you might describe as the beginning of the journey of understanding of anti-abelist pedagogy. And it was interesting at that time, I was also attending a special interest group run by NSEAD on anti-abelism, and they were looking at specifically how this is pedagogy present in schools. And this project was happening in my school, and I thought it would be a really good opportunity to extend some of those kind of understanding. So in terms of the kind of characteristics of anti-abelist pedagogy, some of these are listed up here. The first one specifically talks about using deaf-disabled or neurodivergent artists within the project. That was one thing that kind of fell out, is the, particularly in an educational context moment, that we are looking at cultural capital, because it's on the Ofsted and schools, and they measure schools and judge schools and how you're equipping young people with cultural capital. That being something that we were kind of thinking about, but in a much more kind of inclusive way. So what would a inclusive canon look like? So ensuring that the artists that we were offering up to kind of contextualize the learning for our students were reflective of our young people. And then, you know, the notion around differences in being, seeing and experiencing, and the kind of creative potential that has. There are some tensions within that. In education, because the kind of way that we deliver education in our school is we are still judged and measured by the way that mainstream schools are also Ofsted. So sometimes they can be quite, they they don't support a kind of neurodivergent way of learning, where it can be some tensions within them. The notion about multiple entry points into things, so as opposed to that one way of accessing knowledge, there is multiple ways of accessing it, and that can be through those kind of sensory, experiential, conceptual, but appropriate and non-hierarchical is the most important thing, all of them being equitable. And then that whole kind of co-construction of learning and equity within that. But ensuring, one thing that throughout the kind of project that we kept coming back to was that notion about being seen within the process of education. And the idea of personhood, so people being seen, acknowledged and actualized. So throughout, there were 28 of these, what I describe as characteristics. The curious one, interestingly, fell out of Marc and Luke and how they talked to each other and how they looked and interacted with the young people about being curious of them, of how they were engaging, what they were doing, and how then that offered kind of creative opportunities moving forward. And also the assessment one, much more kind of notion around ipsative, so that idea of self. So as opposed to an externalized notion of assessing that was based on criteria, it was looking at how the young people were coming into the room, engaging with materials and what they might be doing, and that being very much the baseline, and that being a point where you then started to make an assessment. So these are some of the outcomes of that project, and you can see that there is a real kind of diversity of outcomes. So not only is that kind of notion of multiple entry points into doing something, there is a diversity of outcomes as well. And also a range of kind of artistic processes as well, ranging from there was printmaking, drawing, sculpture, performance happening all within that space. We were very lucky because we were funded externally, so we had the luxury of small group work within the art room, which doesn't happen usually. You know, lessons are 45 minutes long and tend to be very kind of rigid in that way. But yeah, really kind of, really interestingly, the young guy, the piece in the middle there, the young person was incredibly interested in transport and modelled a bus, but the implicit kind of ratio and understanding of all those kind of elements to produce that, I thought was really interesting. And then also the one thing that we kind of talked about, particularly with Tanya, was this, within education, you have this notion of special interests within young people who are neurodivergent. But as artists, we talk about this notion of your subjectivity and the thing that you're really interested in, how those kind of things sit within both an educational paradigm, but also within a creative paradigm as well. And then you also had, as opposed to this notion of working towards an exhibition, there were impromptu exhibitions and displays happening throughout this project, which was really interesting as well. And you had group work, you had individual work. So it offered up huge amounts of creative potential. And we, through this, we kind of thought, well, there's some really interesting things happening here. It would be good to start understanding this more. And also for the young people, because they were really engaged with it. And they, I mean, you can see by the range of outcomes, small group of 8 students, it kind of gives you a sense of that. So then we applied for some further funding and we were very lucky to receive that funding. And then we were looking at, we wanted to kind of deepen our understanding of anti-abelist pedagogy at that point, you know, so we could support it within our own school in terms of how it might support us in supporting our young people, and also how we might support other students and in other settings and other schools. Tanya was very helpful in helping us with our research question. So that was our beginning and our kind of point of conversation. So looking at how we were going to generate that knowledge. So as I mentioned previously, that when we enter into kind of partnership working with any kind of organisation or cultural, we co-produce it with them. to ensure that we're having maximum benefit, but then also making sure one of the signifiers of anti-abelist pedagogy was locating the learner centrally without constructing it with the learner. So they were leading consistently, and it moved between that whole notion of facilitation and then intervention, where opportunities to extend that in partnership, and it was action research based. So it was very much around process, but there was no predetermined outcome to it. And there was a range of conversations that happened before the young people came to the art room, and also during the session, so it could evolve very quickly. So it kind of gives you here, this is a display space or a place where young people work in the art room, and Marc and Luke decided to paint that black with blackboard chalk. But we wanted that very early on to have this for everyone, because there was equity with everyone who was in here, with the artists, the teaching assistants, the artists, everyone was an artist. But to be able to create an environment where everyone felt equitable, that they were joint drawing opportunities, where people would draw together over people's work, extend it, and it was very much kind of collaborative. Marc and Luke were very keen to ensure at the very beginning that kind of environment was being facilitated and supported. And Luke did some really interesting things where he would record music. He would record things that were happening and then kind of amplify those sounds back to the students. It's very progressive at points. I know Tanya would come in. It was very kind of progressive arts practice. But yeah, so that was really interesting, because there was often a talk around this idea of curiosity, but also Marc, who's the visual artist, would present materials, a range of materials to the young people that they may not have encountered, and then supporting their kind of curiosity of those materials. And sometimes it took a while for the young people to actually engage with them. But say Marc and Luke would start exploring them, and the students would gradually come over and join in. But however they chose to explore the materials was completely on their terms. And this was a young student who'd only recently joined the school. He was very, very shy. And he was really interested in the corrugated paper, but Marc and Luke filmed how he was interacting with it, and it was quite beautiful. They had a kind of real poetry to how he was exploring it. So that again was one of the kind of signifiers of the project. And being able to, I think one of the luxuries was being able to slow things down and really observe what was happening. Again, I mentioned those kind of characteristics of anti-abelist pedagogy. This was an artist, Naina Clue, who is a neurodivergent, nonverbal, who works with action space, who support artists in their practice, and that was one of her commission pieces. Last year she was in the Royal Academy Summer Show in the centre. She's gaining. She's becoming very famous very quickly. She's had some exhibitions at Blue Chip Galleries, Flowers Gallery, and Carl Friedman Gallery. And I've heard that some of her work is going to be in a national, is being brought into a national collection. So we wanted to introduce this artist, and our students were very interested in tape. This is a screenshot of a video of the young people using the tape. This is also another aspect which was really interesting, because Marc and Luke had become very aware of the how the ring was laid out and the kind of message that kind of presented around hierarchy. Because there is one of the things around this is it was a very unorthodox way of working. The art ring kind of transformed into a studio space. So they would rearrange the art ring so things were different. So there wasn't that kind of teacher hierarchy kind of defined within that space. And even that means flipping tables upside down and doing various things, but very beautiful things were happening through that, and also making connections with artists, and then being able to use a language of neurodivergence or autism with young people. We've started to do that in our school as a consequence of this within some of the art lessons after this, but I can talk about that in terms of some of the implications at the end. Again, that whole notion around multiple entry points, because it was very process based, and there wasn't a uniform way of doing anything. Again, this was a video of a young person who really enjoyed the movement of the wheel, but he was also enjoying colour mixing. And there's a kind of level of performance to it. At working with outside artists who are very progressive in their own practice, visual and music, sound artists, it supported a very different way of working, because there is a what you might describe as an orthodoxy of arts education practice. Again, that was a steal from a video for young people. And it was very much a cross-arts project, so it was visual and sound and singing and lots of different things happening within the mix of the art room. What we would do, I would have conversations with Marc and Luke at the end of some of the sessions, and they would talk to me about what was happening in the room. And one of the things that became quite apparent is, because we decided to take this kind of action research approach, then the number of things that were kind of at play there were huge. You know, the specificity, cultural references of the young people there, you know, also that whole the paradigm that, you know, we were looking at it through an educational lens, but then also an art practice lens, and how, you know, the notion, as I mentioned earlier, the idea of special interest, but then also within lots of artists, their special interest is their subjectivity, their specificity, and their art practice. You know, those things, the idea of phenomenology, you know, being present in space, and that kind of material exploration, equity of dialogue. So there was a number of these conversations that were, I suppose you would say, were kind of provocations of where it might go, but also kind of almost describe the breadth of the space that this kind of offered, and how, you know, where we might or possibly go in the future. You know, there's Marc. He's conversations with Luke, myself, and things that were happening, what they were seeing, what was emerging within the room. And there's a huge amount of documentation that they've done over the course of the project to kind of look at and examine what was going on, both in the moment, but then also through reflection, because they videoed or they recorded some of the sounds of the young people, the communication that's happening between the young people in the room. And these would happen after each session. In terms of findings, there was a very obvious increased engagement for young people. They actively requested art lessons, and as a consequence of that, they now have additional art lessons led by their TAs in the art room. So that's kind of had a structural impact on their educational experience, their self-advocacy as well, their voice, their autonomy. It's also had an impact with their teacher, because the way that the project has been designed, and obviously the kind of positive impacts it's had with young people. Matteo, who's the class teacher, has started to design other areas of the curriculum in relation to that as well. One of the points earlier where I mentioned using neurodivergent artists, I worked with a different group of students who are in the upper school and introduced them to the work of Sonia Bouet, who is a collage artist who uses, she's neurodivergent, but she uses it in a kind of therapeutic fashion and lessons like that. But what occurred to me is that, you know, working in a setting where all of our young people have autism, but we rarely use the term autism or talk about autism, and being able to use or bring that language into the classroom with the young people has proved really, I mean, they produced some amazing collages, and Sonia Bouet was very impressed with them. But they, again, there was an increased engagement and professional conversations at school about being able to talk more about autism within our school. So kind of thinking around that, what was a real strong kind of signifier was the idea of, you know, the art room, because the school is so highly organised and structured, is being able to have a place which was structured, less structured, but more structured by the young people and about what they wanted to explore and experience in that space. And that notion of a creative, a creative divergent space, and it, the opportunities that those kind of, that was able to facilitate for the young people, for the TAs, but also for everyone who was involved within the project, for them to look at things differently, see things differently and possibilities that those things have. So that, again, that was, really, I think, a very powerful thing for us, particularly around those notions around personhood, and that being, I think, a central characteristic of anti-abelist pedagogy. Okay, thinking about it in the kind of bigger space and how it kind of relates to pre-existing pedagogy, it does share a lot in common with inclusive pedagogy or critical pedagogy, and that notion of, liberation, the transformation that education can bring. So I think anti-abelist pedagogy is, because we are looking, it shares a lot of commonality with critical pedagogy, but we're obviously looking at it in an anti-abelist lens, so we're kind of labelling things slightly differently. But it's not a huge departure in lots of ways, it's just a kind of extension on and labelling in a very kind of powerful way, I think. And then also, some real kind of principles of education with like the Vygotsky, with the kind of, more experienced other than the construction. So, that's the kind of, I think, where it sits in that kind of wider context. But in terms of the implications, I think one thing that's become quite apparent within our assessment procedures, creativity isn't described or discussed very much. I think the idea of neurodivergent creativity is an interesting thing that needs further inquiry or further understanding of ways that we could articulate that. I think that kind of philosophical approach of the notion of being seen within the educational process and how that might be supported is elucidated further. Again, I kind of referenced it earlier, but the idea of school art and the orthodoxy of school art and versus art practice, and how we can support both of those and how we can continue that conversation to see how there's commonality between those two paradigms, and then implications, to the wider school curriculum and how that might inform other areas of learning across the school. So I know Marc and Luke are here, so I'm going to hand over. Marc is the visual artist who was involved in the project, and Luke is the musician sound artist. So, guys, I don't know if you want to chip in now.
This is a little brief overview. So the project was 7 weeks long, once every Wednesday. And the top circles are the what we did. So in the first week, we looked at shape. It's a very quick overview, this. Next week, printing, and we had these coloured squashies. In the third week, we introduced the blackboard that we painted. Fourth week, clay and paint. Fifth week, we had lots of tape exploring that you saw there, the Nina Kalu, the taping of the tables. And the sixth week, we explored tapping, and we did printing and paint. And the last week we had charcoal and printing. And the bottom set of circles are just how music was used and accompanied those things. So for the first 4 weeks, it was just improvising with no electronic music. And then in the fifth orange box along from the bottom, I introduced a soundscape that I'd created in response to the week before. And I did the same again in the sixth week. And then in the final week, I used fixed, like, recorded music, but I was resistant to use recorded music. And this takes, yeah, that's great, Marc, yeah, click along. It goes, And so the reason I was resistant to use recorded music or even music is because a pulse or lyrics or melody can fix the entry point into the work. So so even the song that we created, it would just, the hello song was this. And that was purposefully, everyone was invited as they entered the room in their free way to just do this mnumnumning. And we used it throughout in different ways. So that became a song that bookended the arrival and the leaving of each session. In the previous project, we created a song which went, build a home, build a home. And it went on like that. And it was very in the body and that was nice, but we were trying to break away from form. And here you'll hear in this recording now, a couple of little things. I used very long bassoon, low notes to like relax the children, just like a drone. So you'll hear that. And then you'll hear us all doing a bit of minimizing. And we'll, and then I'll pause it then and we'll move on for time's sake. And I'll pause that there, but what you can, what want, sometimes when the class is really up with high energy and they come in, we'd start with the minima, and then we'd go into the throat, numma, then the chest, numma, and then the belly, numma, and just to bring us into our bodies. So you can hear a tiny bit of that here. I'll pause that there. Oh, we've got, we said, let's do you all try it. So here we go. Everyone, just start manamanamaring. just, I can't see you, but just go for it for 10 seconds. Off you go, go. Try some in your head. And in your neck. And in your belly. And that just gives you a flavour of it.
Luke, would you say you were kind of tuning into the energy, and as the students, as the artists arrived, were you tuning into the energy there on that day?
What we're trying to do is people would come in. The wonderful thing about the children is they wouldn't conform to anything, and they come in and go everywhere. So, and we didn't want to tell them to sit down and sit and be in a circle, or sometimes we did, but it was just this idea that they could come in, and sometimes they didn't join in with that. But it was okay. We were just gradually arriving, what we call arriving in our bodies, yep. Arriving in the room, and arriving in the atmosphere. So, and then this little tool transformed. We might be looking at paint, and the paint might be splashing around, and I might go. So we're trying to explore pre-form and pre-language, but it's an invitation to do it. It's not, you know, because everyone does that in their own way, and it's best for people to do it or not, depending on how they feel.
It's an invitation, and, Luke, isn't it? One phrase you often use was an invitation.
We've got a question. The whole,
you've got a question. Yeah?
to understand the children a little better, are these non-speaking children? Are they speaking children? Are they average? Well, it's a special school, but special schools have lots of different types of special schools. So give us a little sense of their profile.
All of the students are verbal.
All the students are verbal?
Yeah.
Average intelligence?
They're accessing what we would describe as a formal curriculum, so around key stage two, key stage one.
Yeah, about. Freaky stage, they're maybe just severely learning, but verbal.
They have limited language there. Some of them are better, some of them are nice students, aged 2 to 11, with some activities, still working really nationally.
What I love, Luke, about what you're describing in your song, in your Hello song, because I've heard lots of special schools who like, hello, da-da, this song that's also on YouTube. What I love about your song is the pre-verbal or the non-words communication, because our kids communicate a lot, with or without words, they're communicating a lot. And what I love about your welcome song is that you're accessing their own exploration of their voice. My experience with kids in this group is that they use their voice a lot, regardless of whether or not they have words, and they're using their voice in lots of different ways and express, and lots of emotions get expressed to the voice. And I love that you've done that in sort of in how you created the welcome song.
We're trying to invite preform, because Marc will talk later about figurative line drawing and inviting children to explore the charcoal, explore the pencil. But we found actually that us as adults have a more tricky time with accepting something like this as an exploration, because it can often seem like it's low quality or disorganized, and that's not what it is. But getting that across in a really lovely way where everyone can just dip into it is part of what we've been learning how to do. But then sometimes what would emerge once we'd arrived in the space, and it would be very much a flowing sort of energy sort of scape with lots of different things going in, and then suddenly something might emerge, and in this case somebody had a flower, and song and melody came out, but it arose from the situation. So you'll hear the melody, and I start playing melody on the bassoon. But so just have a listen. You'll hear the child talk about the flower. And I'll pause that there, because this whole thing about story, and I think, Marc, do you want to take over now and for a minute?
Just yeah, Luke. I mean, it's so beautiful, isn't it? We're responding in the moment, aren't we? This idea came to us about, well, it's Paul summarized, we're creating spaces. And this was this is a really, really good example. We had this wall that we asked permission for Paul and Tanya to be able to paint it blackboard black. And it was just breaking away a little bit from the normalcy of the way the children occupy, you know, are in their classroom and coming to the art room. So not on an A3 or an A4 piece of paper, but suddenly this expanse of space, you know, and potential. And I think, Luke, if we just go onto the next slide, Paul included this one. There were many co-produced collaborative drawings. I think 4 different hands worked on this drawing. So this idea that Paul said about working alongside, about empathizing, collaborating together. There were 2 learning assistants and 2 students. And in the sounding, and it came out of, Luke, an exploration of chalk, I remember this particular morning, we were doing the monominums. We spent time arriving ourselves and then exploring with Paul, you know, talking, reflecting from the previous week. We arrived with the students with the monominums, and we this invitation to explore the material, and we were sounding with the material. This board structure in the room was almost like a musical instrument. It became made sounds as we were drawing. And the second, there are these kind of drawn areas by an artist called, who was really exploring the chalk. But we invited all of the artists working together to really sort of investigate the qualities of the chalk. And some, one particular artist, Alex, went into figuration, started drawing a bus and drawing a cat's head, right-hand side and into the middle a little bit. And you can, that became a starting point, an entry point into an imaginative world that he developed later on that day. Really lots to say about it, but it was a beautiful moment for me personally, because I found myself just taking a step back and just, you know, almost like Luke and I talk about this a lot. It's almost like sometimes you're just, it's the not doing anything. You've created the right environment, and Luke calls it a climate where creativity can flourish. This, that a flower can emerge and grow in the minds and in the material. So I just found myself almost walking backwards, you know, it's leaving, stepping away, you know, taking my hands away and just allowing it to happen. But that's such a thing. It's such a beautiful thing, Luke, isn't it? But, you know, obviously there's more we can say, but they were the key things I wanted to say, really, about the drawing.
Oh, well, this follows on nicely from it, because in the week we did printing, I've got here a recording of us doing the printing, but we considered everything to be creative and everything to be the art, the experience, as well as the making, as well as what was being created. And here you'll hear a recording of the sound. And if you, for me, I'll just say personally, the rhythmic strikes in these prints and the act of they banging the table to do it, it all sort of creates a kind of a whole piece of music which has got this quality of energy to it. And then you'll hear it just die away. And what happens is we just have these little waves of energies. So one minute we'd pop up into a story and song. The next minute the making might be happening and the actual making would be the thing. So here, have a listen and see if you find any correlation between the atmosphere of the sounds and what you can see. And then it dies away. And
it's just so, they're just such amazing moments, aren't they? And we've got more to, so in the time we've got, let's, yeah, keep going. Luke, would you like to give a...
Yeah.
No, you say what you were going to say.
No, well, I mean, it's funny that little recording then, suddenly it reminded me of the composer Stravinsky and what he was doing in 1913 around breaking out of form. Mm-hmm. And... but with this picture you can see now, this is just the day. So Mark and myself would arrive 2 hours early, and I would often spend an hour walking through Hyde Park very slowly to get in my body. And then we'd just have 2 hours and we'd try things out and we'd really make time to arrive. And Paul would come in and we'd have a chat and we'd do a bit on the board of exploring ideas and reflections. We'd have class one for 40 minutes. And then class two, and then in lunch we'd have a bit more reflection, and then in the afternoon it would be in the reverse order, class two now for 30 minutes, a bit shorter, and then class one. And then at the very end of the day we would have one of or the other class for a final 30 minutes, And then people would pop in at the end. Tanya used to pop in and say hello and have a chat with us, and Paul and some of the teaching assistants. So that just gives you a little overview of what a day was like. More of the mind mapping.
So this is an example of the beginning, wasn't it, Luke? I mean, I will just say 10 seconds. We were sort of with Paul and Tanya trying to explain to each other what was happening and how to articulate it. So we were in these constant conversations all the time, weren't we, and experimenting ourselves.
Paul?
Yeah, sorry. I was just going to interrupt. I think one of the interesting points is the working with Marc and Luke, who are obviously, I've talked about that point in the presentation earlier, that obviously I'm the art teacher in the school, but I have an orthodoxy of practice that is, I teach in a certain way within a certain time frame with a certain kind of, you can hear the conversations between Marc and Luke, who are very progressive kind of music and sound artists, a different kind of view take and how they kind of facilitate that kind of practice. And how that kind of varies from the kind of orthodoxy. And it was, I think that was where some of the real kind of value came in, because it became we talked about, again, going back to that previous kind of conversation about creating a kind of divergent space where lots of things become possible, the opportunities that kind of presented. So, I mean, I think that just kind of illustrates to those kind of points, but I don't know if anyone's got any questions around any of the what you've seen so far. They were organised into small groups that would come in. So they would have the usual timetable in a day, but they would, I think, 3 to 4 students would then come into the art room at that point. So it would be very much a normal school day for the students, apart from having this time in the art room in their small group.
And were you recording the entire time, or?
I think Luke and Marc produced a huge amount of documentation that they produced. There was a lot, because what Luke did is he kind of recorded lots of things to then reflect on it, and he made soundscapes of previous days to then reflect, or if he heard something, he would amplify that sound and then see if that facilitated the students when they came back into the room. Also being able to listen to hear what was happening.
That's just comment on that. The previous slide, Luke, you know that this was actually, or is it the next one after the diagram, the sort of mind map, that one? Processing these beautiful ideas that Luke was coming to about the way we're arriving in the moments with the students, in ourselves and with the students, this kind of process. And what sort of came to me, you recorded all the sessions that you recorded, every single session in the first 3 or 4 weeks, and transcribed them just to go, what is happening? and then you would explain, you become aware that you only perceive so much. There's only so much you sort of take in a way. There was so much that was unseen in the room, and that became a huge thing to investigate. And I had an orthodoxy, Paul, about the way I was recording the things that were made. Our emphasis was on the creative process, but still you're left with these incredible products. And we had this, if you can see in the diagram there, about 3/4 of the way down, it's product and process. But I realized when I was drawing this diagram to explain what had happened to myself, I had to extend the process to a huge area of unseen process. For example, Luke started talking about all of the artists, all of the children were communicating with each other, almost like bird song. They were conveying to each other emotionally. There were waves, this kind of waves of energy going around the room,
Marc, we've got another question.
Yes, Marc, sorry, just to say that we only have 8 minutes left, so it's been really good to have some questions at
this end. Shall I stop the presentation, or should we just show you this one last thing?
Yeah.
It's very short, but it does this idea about birdsong. One of the children here is on, it's the still that Paul showed you before. But what I discovered was, in the first 2 or 3 weeks, if the children would improvise, make sound, I, like a musician, would try and listen to their sound and communicate with them through it or improvise with them. And what I started to understand when I listened back to the recordings was, when I tried to do that, I stopped what they were doing. And I thought, what do I need to do? And I thought, I need to be in myself as an artist and let them stay in their self. So what you'll hear now is me making sounds coming over to on this spinning thing. And I make sound, but I make it in my own way for myself. And I let him make sound. And if you listen to the quality of his sounds, they're very musical and they're really in the act. But I never try to engage with him directly, like as if I'm trying to make a jazz improvisation. Hope this makes sense. Here we go. Now it sounds like a lot of me that, but that sound he made, you know, it's all connected. And I specifically didn't start going, I stayed where I was. And I found that 1 week, one of the paint brushes went up my nose and nearly start, you know, I just don't know how to get out of this. And what happened was, I'll stop presenting there.
I'm so sorry to interrupt, but we have a few questions. We only have 5 minutes left.
So sorry.
A quick question. Did you notice any differences in the sensory tolerances of the children over the period of time that they were with you? Because you created such a nicely relaxed environment, and I just wonder whether by reducing anxiety and letting the children explore and decide what they wanted to sort of work with, whether you noticed a shift in particularly those who maybe had some tactile sensitivity issues or didn't like having messy hands or sticky hands, and whether you saw things change or it wasn't something that you necessarily were measuring or looking out for. Or
no, definitely. What's coming to you, Luke? I mean, I've got Sahil, the story of Sahil.
Go for it.
Shall I say? So Paul mentioned this young man, the young artist earlier, new to the school, was very shy and didn't want to even touch anything. And he just really blossomed. I mean, love to show you what happened.
He stood in the corner, completely silent, and wouldn't do anything, just stood there staring. And we got a massive roll of corrugated cardboard out in the week 2 or 3. And he started to engage with that. Then by week 4 or 5, he started sounding and all kinds of things.
Drawing on the boards, drawing over other people's drawings, you know, yeah. I mean, it was beautiful, absolutely beautiful. Too many things, you know, you can tell by now we've got too many things to show you.
Being in tune with like the soundscape, treating the whole room as a soundscape,
yeah,
meant that if it was kind of falling apart or it was getting too much, it just let itself die down. And because anything was considered music or art, anything could happen, and that could be like woven into what we were doing.
Yeah.
So it reminded me, I said to Mark, of, you know, starlings, when they're moving, these shifts and shapes.
Yeah.
It's like a fabric. And in the end, if it did get too much and there was too many senses going on, the whole thing would just collapse, and we'd just let it collapse. And we'd let the TA, the teaching assistants, come in. So it was very fluid and multi. We called it multi-point, multiverse. So
we were in the multiverse, weren't we? That was Owen Smith's phrase we used. Another question?
I definitely don't want to cut you off. I could listen to your work for a couple more hours, to be honest. It's just fantastic. A couple different things. First, about the two of you. How did you come to this project? You know each other before? Had you worked with this profile of students before? And if you hadn't, has it changed any of your perspectives?
Hugely. Do you want me to go, Mark?
Go.
We started, Mark and I started working 11 years ago at the National Gallery in the Wallace Collection. And I think our naivety in many ways in special needs educational work has helped us to do different things. And this particular project started with Open City 3 years ago. And we had an original project manager who was quite creative and let us have lots of freedom. So we could, we had to make a building, but there was, we had a lot of freedom with that. We discovered lots of things then. The year after, the teacher was, had come from a secondary school and wanted to put a lot of control on what we were doing. And we resisted that control. But because of our friendship and intuition and way of working together, we were able to, I don't know, it's just this, we're good friends and we're just constantly reflecting. We just, we're both really interested. And we did this project one day a week, but we talked about it for like 4 days in between, you know. So I don't know, I've probably gone off your question there a bit. But
well, that's not too, no, I think that's very helpful. But I'd love to understand if your perception of children with severe learning disabilities, how that, what your perception is now, how did it evolve? And did it change your perception at all about human beings? I know this is a very broad question, but.
Massive, absolutely massive. Sorry, Mark, it's because.
No, go for it, go for it.
Call it, I had another slide called The Problem. But, you know, but it was this thing about humans being locked in thinking, going, doing, subject-object relationships, form. And it was about getting into another dimension. And what we really believe, as well as anti-ableism, is that these children show us another paradigm in their art and in their making. And yeah, I would say this project has fundamentally changed the way we work with children with special needs, but it's also changed the way that we view this practice and even live our own lives. Yeah, Mark, do you want to say?
I think on a larger scale, I think a lot in our society, we segregate off special needs.
Yes.
And the more disabled someone is, the more uncomfortable that makes us feel. Maybe we're feeling afraid of our own vulnerabilities and our own ability to become disabled. But we shove them off to the side and we think of them as not human. But for those of us who enter their world, the more we're in their world, we see, we don't challenge our concept of humanity, we reaffirm it. There's some very basic things, personally thinking, and as artists, it feels as if that was coming through in your art and how you worked. And what was lovely to see that you were doing the anti-SEND school, if I may. You weren't giving a lot of structure because SEND schools for severely and profound disabled children, and there has to, the pedagogy seems to be, and I'm not an educator, to be structure. Don't change the routine, make sure it's exactly the same. And also the other thing about SEND schools is it focuses on the deficits, yeah? The children can't say this, they can't put on their clothing, they can't go to the toilet, let's focus on the deficits and hardly anything to do with their strengths. So hardly anything about their free will, about how to walk into the room and use the room. And then also then their strengths. And what's beautiful about what you've done, sorry, my last point, no, actually it's the second one. What's beautiful about what you've done is so many second SEND schools for this population are trying to train up the young adults when they get to secondary school to serve coffees or to stand at a till in the London Transport Underground. Now, neither of those two skills are particularly autism friendly. One is making you be in a social environment, and one is making you in a busy environment that's a little bit antisocial. There is, for example, there's a store you might want to flag, some called Revere the Residents in Stoke Newington Church Street, which is by a mum and her disabled child, and all the artwork, the crafts really, that are sold for the residents are made by people with disabilities. It's beautiful stuff. It's just amazing stuff. And that blackboard that you showed us a few times, it's like Basquiat step aside. I mean, that what the, your children created, your artists created, was absolutely stunning. And I can't help but thinking that instead of serving coffees, maybe we should be working with our children to develop their creativity and sharing it. I said that was the second to last because I wanted to leave a couple of thoughts with you. Luke, I think your soundscape belongs on Slow Radio. I don't know if you listen to the BBC's Slow Radio show.
Oh, no,
you must. So that's something to flag for you. But they do incorporate natural sounds with musical sounds. And sometimes it's nature, sometimes it's voices, but it's just brilliant. And also just to flag for you, divergent sounds or divergent music at the National Theatre in May Welcome Trust funded, organized by some of our colleagues here at King's. But that music is composed by non-divergent musicians, but is based on the interpretation of life experience by autistics who are more able, so more average intelligence. But it's their recounting of what it is like being autistic, then musically interpreted, and tickets are like £1 if you want to just pay £1 at the National Theatre.
Thanks so much.
Sorry.
Oh. Brilliant. And there's another meeting just coming in, but thank you so much, Luke.